This is Creativity Drill with Dr. Don and Jonathan Rundman.
Hello, everybody. I gotta talk quietly right now because my entire household is sleeping. It's 1:26 a.m. as I record this, and they're asleep and I am awake editing today's episode, which we wrapped up a little while ago with our guest Richard Bruxvoort Colligan, who is a songwriter and musician, and we think you'll really enjoy our visit with Richard. We go way, way back with him. He's one of our great friends and longtime collaborators. In fact, when Dawn and I got married long time ago, Richard was there at the wedding, and he sang a song at the wedding. So how about that? That's a long history. Let's cut to the chase and hear from Richard Bruxvoort Colligan.
Hey! Have a seat.
This is so fun that you're doing this.
You know what's great about this appearance of yours is you're the first person to be a guest who has heard the actual podcast.
Oh, yeah. I'm your first non-virgin.
That's right. Because everything else, we were kind of getting it in the can before
it was very theoretical.
We posted anything. So
yeah.
But you were just mentioning online that you had been listening, and then that conversation led to your appearance here now, because I had no idea you were coming to Minnesota.
It was kind of spur of the moment, but it worked out great.
If you want, you can put the headphones on and hear yourself, or not, whatever.
That'll just baffle me.
Okay.
I'm so easily confused.
So just, you can even get a little closer and talk loud.
All right.
And welcome, Richard.
Hey, thank you.
Welcome.
We are on the air as such, and so we can be just totally chilled out, and we'll ask you some stuff, and you can tell us about your adventures. And, well, maybe we could start with, what are you doing here?
Well, my wife Trish was really teasing me because this all made perfect sense to me at the time, but I had a thing up here to play for a studio thing, a record of my friend David, so that's tomorrow. And then it turns out he needed a ride from the airport because he's coming in from Baltimore tonight. So, okay, well, I'll just pick him up and stay overnight. And then I'm thinking, you know, this was weeks ago. Great, because I also need to go through La Crosse and pick up my guitar that got smashed and is now repaired.
Did you take it to Dave's?
Yes.
I love that place.
Legendary Dave's. I love Dave.
How did your guitar get smashed? That's just, it's very sad.
It was, I felt it more than I thought I would. Because I feel like I'm not quite as attached to my instrument as I know some musicians are. So it was after a youth event. And usually if some youth-type person expresses some interest in music, comes up, you know, I'll say, oh, you should try my guitar. Or you play guitar? You've wanted to play guitar? Here, let me just show you. Or if it's somebody really young, I'll hold it and let them strum, and I'll do some left-hand fretting or something, and we'll do Wheels on the Bus or something. So this nice gal comes up. I said, oh, try this on. And she did. And that was fine. And then, well, yeah, fast forward a little bit. And the strap had sort of come off the pin in a weird way. It was folded over and dropped like 2 feet to the floor. And there was a thud and a crack.
Oh.
And I said something like, oh, my God. There's no
That's
covering
like dropping
up.
A baby, you know? It's like,
oh. And this gal just stood there. I mean, this was after the event, so she had participated in this whole event this weekend. Oh, she felt so bad. She was crying, and we're talking about it. I know she feels awful, so I'm saying, you know, this is going to be okay. It's just an instrument. I have insurance on it. I'll get it repaired, replaced. Just, I don't want you to worry about this, okay? I'm talking with her because this is a big deal, and I'm thinking, you know, in sort of a pastoral way, too, you know, I want this to be something that She might have had a great weekend up until now, you know, and I don't want this to wreck her weekend. But so then from across the room, one of the youth leaders, adults, you know, comes across saying, oh my gosh, I just heard what happened. I just saw that. Man, that's awful. That's like, you know, your best friend dying or something. I'm like, dude, this is not the, no. And so I'm saying now, because she's standing right in front of me. He's coming up. Oh, it's just an instrument. I'm talking to him now. It's just an instrument. But I'm saying that for her. And yeah. anyway, so took it to Dave's, and they got me set up.
That's a great store. It's one of the best probably in the country.
Yeah, it's, just to see everything lined up in the wood, just the beautiful instruments. I mean, I don't know that much about guitars. I know a lot of people that are disappointed that come up to me after a concert. They want to talk tech or what kind of guitar is that? Is that have the Rosewood thing with the flywheel with the thing? And I don't know any of that. But I could, you know, spend some time just sort of, can I pick this one up? Is that all right?
Yeah, I always try to be sure my guitar has a really beautiful flywheel.
Or, you know,
are you making that part up?
The crossover bar with the 3/4 inch that side.
Jack? The buttress, like the curly maple buttress is important.
Oh, you've got that model. Wow, yeah.
So yeah. Did you play the instrument at Dave's? Did they do a nice job?
It was. I mean, that thing had a crack that was like raised up and it kind of, yeah. So they said they did a nice job. It's playable and yeah. I was mostly relieved to have it back in my hands because I did sort of miss it.
That's the Taylor that you play. That's kind of like a jumbo thing, right?
What size is it? It's not the jumbo.
But it's got a cutaway thing.
Yeah. Yeah, it's not the auditorium. It's like mini. In between.
Okay.
The giant shrimp. The
A few years ago, I was on tour and I flew to Colorado and I had my regular touring guitar, the Gibson that I always have, and it was in its regular case, and I got a rental car at the airport, and it was a tiny little super economy rental car, and I had put the guitar in the trunk, and then I got to the gig and played, and then after the gig, I went back to the rental car to put my guitar in, and I put the guitar in the trunk, and I stood it up on its side instead of laying it down on its back. Yeah. You know, so the case was sort of standing the tall way.
Yeah.
And then I slammed the trunk.
Right.
But this economy rental car had a hinge system that had kind of a low-hanging, curvy support rig that held the hinge to the trunk lid. So when I slammed the trunk, this quite beefy metal bar came down and crushed the instrument.
Oh.
And I did it myself because I slammed the trunk.
It's like a nutcracker.
Exactly.
I can picture that.
It was sort of like a leverage, a feat of leverage in physics. And so then, of course, when I opened it up, I had cracked. It was exactly like a walnut sort of situation. And I had cracked the frame the long way. And it was bad. And my guitar is awesome, you know, and I felt horrible about it. So I came back and I brought the instrument here. I think it was Hoffman Guitars in St. Paul. It's in Minneapolis, I guess, over by Augsburg College. And they fixed it. And
how many endorsement deals do you guys have so far?
Well, we're talking about all these businesses now that should sponsor the Creativity Drill podcast. But they fixed it, and they fixed it beautifully, and it plays great. In fact, I think it's better now than before I crushed it. Because it sounds incredible, and I think, you know, when they fixed it, they set it up really nice.
Yeah.
So now, it's funny, sometimes after the wreck, it has a special quality, so hopefully your guitar is like that.
It's got a nice scar.
Yeah.
Battle scar.
I feel like that we need to start this out by saying, this podcast contains disturbing material. Because I think anyone anyone who plays an instrument and thinks about smashing your guitar, dropping your guitar. It's visceral almost, when the wincing.
Well, I think it's awesome that you're here to for a studio session. That's so cool. So tomorrow you're going to go in, and what are you going to do? Are you going to sing or play or what?
It's some guitar work.
Wow. Yeah. Is there already rhythm tracks?
That's what I think. I think there's drums, Bösendorfer, really nice arrangements with... Yeah, David Lohman has some great songs.
And what studio are you working at?
You know, I don't remember. His brother's engineering it, but it's just going to be great. David is such a good writer and really progressive things for the church. So these would be like congregational hymns, new things.
Yeah.
And he's got a real musical, like musical theater background. So everything is just, wow, it's very big, and modulations and vocal arrangements just rock.
Do you know the songs already?
I know mine pretty well.
Okay.
And there's charts, so we're working that out.
Oh, that's so cool. Well, have fun in the studio. Well, I'm glad you could get here to talk to us on your way to the airport to get him. And so the timing is excellent. So thanks for coming.
Well, yeah. You know, when I just discovered the podcast a couple weeks ago, I think, or whenever. I must have got wind of it right after you launched it.
Yeah, well, I posted it on less than a week ago. I think I posted it on Friday, and then I leaked it on Twitter, just for anybody on Twitter. But then I made it really more public on Facebook on the Saturday, and then a ton of people down. I was amazed. We were getting like, you know, 50 to 100 listens, or at least downloads, a day. And then by the fourth day, we had over 200 already. So the numbers were way bigger than I ever thought there would be.
I'm not surprised. When I saw it, I wasn't surprised at all that you were doing it. It was more like, yes. Yeah. Don and Jonathan are doing this. Like, of course they're doing it. You two are two of the most creative people I know. Like around music and the arts and writing and everything, but also around family and just your way in the world. So I just love this that you're doing it.
Well, we've been talking about it for about a year.
Yeah.
And we had to decide on what it was going to be called, and we had to decide on what we were going to focus on. And part of the thing was that we really wanted it to be the two of us always hosting it together, just because we wanted something to do together that was be a project that belongs to both of us, and it's just more fun.
Yeah, well, I like it a lot. And at first I saw how that, oh, these are like over an hour, like, and I'm used to podcasts that are, you know, This American Life, wait, and, you know, program sorts of things that are like an hour. And so I wondered, oh, is that gonna feel too long? And I really like it, because it slows me down. It's like, oh, this is an unedited conversation. It really is sitting down, and it's more of a real-time experience than what I'm used to, which is sort of cramming information into my ears while I'm doing something else, like driving or whatever.
Yeah.
So it's really, really refreshing. I really like it.
All my favorite podcasts are like 90 minutes to 2 hours long. And they're this kind of format, which is why I thought this is how it's got to be. Because when I'm listening, I listen when driving on a road trip where I've got to drive to Chicago or something. And I can just spend 2 hours just listening, and it makes the time go by so fast. And I also listen a lot to podcasts when I'm folding laundry and when I'm doing the dishes, where I know like I'm going to be just doing some task for about an hour that I need my hands to do or my eyes to do, but I can listen to something.
Yeah.
And man, I'm a big podcast fan, and I really thought, man, I would love to contribute to the repertoire if possible. So,
yeah. So here we are.
Here we are.
Excellent.
Well, I'm glad you liked it. And I thought too, you know, you're one of the people who I know who is super deliberate about creativity, and you're one of the people that I've collaborated with creatively longer than anybody else I've ever known.
Yeah.
So, probably.
Like, and we've done all sorts of collaborations in many different ways. So, like, we've worked in the studio together. We've performed in concert together. We've written songs together. I've been in your audience. You've been in my audience.
Yeah.
I mean, just about every... We've been on tour together, you know, so just about every way that you can, at least in the music business, kind of collaborate, you and I have had a chance to do that.
Yeah.
And ever since even the very early days of that, like, it seems like to me that you've been really deliberate about your creative process, you know, like setting aside time to write and keeping stuff written down in notebooks. And, you know, hosting conversations with other writers and hosting like the Songcrafting Summit and then, you know, writing newsletters and blogs. I mean, you're really...
You're committed.
And you're into the process. Talk about that a little bit.
I love being around creative people. I just love to be that's why I love your podcast. It's about, you know, how is this person creative? How do they think? When I was at Luther College, it was a psychology major I ended up with, but I was never a career track sort of person. So I was just sort of taking all the stuff that seemed interesting. And even my junior year, I hadn't really declared a major yet. My advisor sat me down. Okay, we really have to nail this down. And I said something like, well, you've got my transcript there. What does it look like I'm going to major in? And he said, well, we could go, you know, philosophy, a couple other classes, could be biology, psychology, psychobiology. There's some things in the mix there, but I'm really glad that I was into psychology and they had a great faculty there. Because I love just thinking about how people think. As much as you could walk through the world and think, oh, everybody is kind of doing their thing in the same way. Everyone has their own little universe, in their own way they're interpreting things, their own, you know, meaning that's loaded into every small thing, their own body, their perceptions of other people, how they do family, friendship, all that. So when it comes to a particular craft like songwriting, I just love to hear, you know, tell me how that works for you. What happens? Really, there was a really great magazine. What was it called? Performing Songwriter?
Yeah.
Do you know what I'm talking about?
Yep, totally.
The Lydia did. Yeah, it was like the best. It was like the only journal, one of the only journals I ever read, like top to bottom, front to cover.
It was a really great magazine.
Yeah.
I think I was a subscriber the whole time that it existed.
Yeah. Well, I love that because she didn't, with the interviews, didn't spend any time on fame or anything. Whoever she was talking to, you know, whether it was, you know, Billy Joel or, you know, some big name, it was just, no.
The craft.
Yeah. What kind of pencil do you use? Or, you know, paper, you know.
What's your discipline? And,
how do you really do that?
Yeah. Were you always sort of going back a few years even before you were at Luther? And when you think about the teenage Richard or the child Richard or, you know, just sort of this, I think it's such a gift and I think it's really unusual to have such an interest in other people's stories. Because so many people are kind of interested in just telling their own story, but not necessarily, or they don't know, they don't listen in, or I don't know, that just seems to be a gift of yours, to be really engaged with hearing about other people's stories.
I don't know how old I was. I suppose it was fifth or sixth grade. I really loved listening to the radio. So every morning I'd get up like extra early. This was Rochester, Minnesota. But we got Twin Cities Radio. We lived on top of a hill, so we could get FM from, we got like KS95, and it was Nap and Donuts in the morning, sort of pre-morning zoo thing. And then, what was the other station? It's evolved since then. Anyway, you know, a couple of guys playing some records, but also, you know, talking about news and silly stuff. I'd get up early and put on headphones and just sit there in the dark till the rest of my family woke up, just kind of listening to the banter and listening to the songs. Once I learned to play guitar, part of how I learned was just sort of listening to Top 40 radio and trying to figure out how to play along with whatever was there. And there's always music in our house. Like dad plays banjo, organ, piano, guitar, like that. And mom sings with us in church. She would say she's not, you know, that great a singer or even a musician, but there's always like creative stuff happening in the house. And I think it was part of my formation, partly through church too, that music is something you share. And there's a lot too. There's great significance in sharing a song, whether we're singing that together or listening together.
I want to connect to your comments about being a psych major, because one of the things that I think is fun about doing this podcast is to have Dawn as a host, as a psychologist, and thinking about it from a scientific point of view and from a brain point of view.
Yeah.
And so I'm just wondering, what do you think, Dawn, about what's going on in the brain of someone like...
Your subject awaits.
Of someone listening to the radio and when they're an adolescent and... You know, and then even like think about psychology, like Dawn's is a research psychologist, but like your psychology approach to me anyway as a listener is kind of therapeutic, and I can hear that in the lyrics.
Oh, yeah,
and
maybe
even in your personality, to
you're,
me,
you're very balm-like.
Tell me how you feel about that. I think my parents are both good listeners.
Oh, and wait a minute! And aren't your parents psychologists? Or your dad?
My dad's a psychologist, and mom is an RN. So both of those are kind of caregiving,
helping professions.
Yeah,
listening and
right. So I have that tendency in myself, I suppose, that sometimes has felt a little dysfunctional. Like that's a very, I do think I have a gift for that sort of presence of listening, but I've often worn that hat really tightly. Like this is my job, this is my role, and that's my function. And then sort of being locked into that, where I maybe in the past haven't felt like I can share who I am or ask somebody else to help me out. So yeah, patterns are powerful things.
So you were an early bird. Are you still an early bird? Getting up before everybody else?
I don't know if I know. I say that because I like having time to myself in the morning. But I really love sleep. Isn't sleep just really good? So these days, I don't know. I kind of get up when my family gets up, I guess.
You even have a love song for sleep.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
what are some of the lyrics to that?
Well, I've written a couple songs about sleep. One was called Da Vinci Slept Like a Baby. And it's just the idea that sleep is such an unusual thing. And just think about, what time is it now? Whatever time it is, it's getting towards evening. In a few hours, almost everybody in your block is just going to fall unconscious, you know, for like 7 or 8 hours. I just think that's weird to think about. And it's been happening as long as humans have been around. So there's a verse about, you know, Da Vinci sleeping, and a verse about Abraham Lincoln sleeping, and about Margaret Thatcher sleeping, and how dream life works and how it's nourishing sleep is, usually,
and
but
restorative
it
as
can
far as
be
everything that chemically and biologically,
yeah,
yeah,
but that for some of us it's a real challenge. Some of us sleep is really difficult, and there's, you know, things like insomnia, or if you have a stretch of that, or even if it's a chronic thing, why, when that doesn't work, it makes everything really difficult.
Yeah.
But for some of us, like for me, my wife has a little insomnia sometimes, and I'm no help to her because I can fall asleep just about anywhere, any place, any time, and I snore. So there's no help for me at all. But I'm just kind of fascinated with that, yeah, that for some of us it comes really easy, and it's restorative, and it's this whole brilliant sort of life and dreams where I feel like, for me at least, it's sort of an integrative time, or I imagine it helps heal things and make sense of things that, you know, I'm tired of doing consciously.
Yeah, yeah.
And it's still cooking through the night.
Have you ever dreamed a song, or have you ever woken up from a sleep and said, I gotta record this right now, or has anything creative sort of struck you in your sleep, or just maybe a dream that affects something else later that you do creatively?
Yeah, well, just last night I was I had dinner with our mutual friend Kathy, and was telling her about a dream I had with her, and this dream, it was one of those that doesn't make any sense, the most interesting ones anyway. We were at a party and we were sitting on the same couch, and I was asking her how she's feeling, and she wasn't feeling very good, and her body was giving her trouble. She was in some pain, and then something happened, whoosh, in the dream where we were like weeks or months into the future, and we were in different clothing, and I was asking her exactly the same question, and she said, my body forgot. And what she meant was, she was talking about how my understanding in the dream, I just knew this, that she was thinking that her body has patterns or habits that have caused some pain. and that her body had forgotten all those patterns and habits that were destructive, and now she was feeling fine. Mm. But what a weird thing to say, my body forgot. As a spiritual director, sometimes I think about how bodies do know things that sometimes we don't know that they know. Uh-huh. So when anniversaries of, you know, traumatic things come around on the calendar, you might not know it right away, but I've had people remind me, oh, wasn't it this time of year that, you know, that happened or whatever? And you go, oh, yeah, right. And take a deep breath and it touches into some grief or loss or joy or whatever. Mm-hmm. But kind of mysterious.
Yeah.
Well, it seemed like there's something in that thing about a body forgetting or a body remembering. That seems like a some sort of poem or a song or something might come out of that.
Yeah.
I know that Trish, your wife, is a spiritual director and has clients and stuff, but you do too?
Not these days. No, I kind of consider what I do with congregations a posture of spiritual direction with a group.
Do they arrange with you formally to be a consultant for a period of time with them or anything like that?
Not usually. There's been some consulting I've done with congregations that are in the midst of some transition where they're wanting worship life to change or music needs to change or pastoral leadership changes, some sort of transition that signals, okay, we need to spend some extra care with this. So let's bring in somebody to help steer us a little bit or just to stimulate something new. But mostly it's been, you know, visiting for a day or two.
Mm-hmm. You know, primarily in your adult life, really since college, you've never had a regular job, right? I mean, you've been a performer.
Uh-huh. A 9-to-5
A touring artist. You operated a studio. You were an engineer and a producer. And you've been a freelance sort of singer-songwriter. And, you know, now you're kind of a musical consultant for individuals and groups and retreats and conferences and things. One of the things I'm interested in as this podcast goes along and we talk to more people is the chance to talk to somebody whose career is actually measurable in a long-term sort of way. Because you're not a beginner. You know, you've been doing this for 25 years or something.
What? Speak up, Sonny.
And what I think is so interesting about that is I think once you get long enough into a creative career, you can look backwards on it with more clarity than maybe if you'd only been doing it for 5 years.
Yeah.
And you can see these giant phases and these evolutions. And so I'd love to know, like, when you think about all the different ways you've been involved in music and creativity, like, what were those phases for you and what was it like and what did you learn at each stage? Or do you feel like you're picking up new tricks nowadays? I don't know. What is that like?
That's a great question. When you were talking about that, like a long arc of a career, I'm thinking about some of the artists I enjoy studying, you know, have that sort of catalog, like James Taylor, where you can say, okay, he's a grandpa now, but his first records, he was, you know, in a very different place.
For me, these days, my big inspirations are long-time career artists.
Yeah.
So, like, recently I've been really into Annie Lennox and Todd Rundgren and Bruce Coburn, all who were making albums in the 70s and are still making albums now and never stopped. And it's such a long time, yet you can look backwards across the decades and see all these detours and zigzags and ebbs and flows in their process. But they always did good work and they always were trying something new and they were always performing and, you know, ups and downs and whatever. But I just think that's incredible. And so even you can do that because you've been around long enough.
Well, maybe so. I'd like those artists to study artists like that too, because it seems like that's an example of people, James Taylor, Paul Simon. I've been listening to Rick Springfield again, just thinking over time, they're documenting a really creative life. They're paying attention to what's really what's really important to them. That's the music they're making. And so, oh, here is the record where he was married to this person. And then a phase goes by and, well, now he was married to this person. And here's where James Taylor was a grandpa. And, or here's when, you know, Rick Springfield had that record. What was it called with the sort of therapy language on it?
Oh, shock, denial, sure. Anger, acceptance. I'm so glad you mentioned Rick Springfield because he's one of my favorite people. And Dawn always jokes that...
lovingly jokes.
That lovingly jokes that, like, it's funny that I love Rick Springfield. But I do. And, man, he's got a long career. And he has very distinct periods.
Yeah, I agree.
That are so measurable. But I think all have good stuff in each phase.
Yeah.
And now he's 65 years old or something.
Isn't that amazing?
Yeah. Yeah.
I have a list on the fridge that I made a few weeks ago of people I wanted to see in concert. And he's on it, and they might be Giants, and Dylan, and David Byrne. And it's sort of a growing list, just to have that there to remind myself to every once in a while just see if anybody's coming to town.
Yeah, yeah.
But he's a person I would really like to see because of that sense of a career. I mean, how wonderful to feel like you are, as an artist, not only, you know, paying attention to your life and documenting that as self-reflection, but also as a practice that's really helpful to other people. I think anytime we're sharing stories with each other, you know, and I can say, oh, that gives me some insight. I never thought about processing a story of mine like you're talking about. I feel like that's a chance for humanity to bloom. Mm-hmm. For each person. So to me, a lot of songs are like that, are stories. Or, well, here's one person's take on, you know, this thing that happened to her or to him. I think the only Rick album I don't like is that cover album.
Oh, yeah.
They did. For some reason, I wanted him to take more chances with it, take more risks with it.
Yeah, I have it, and I listened to it one time.
The day after the day after yesterday.
I think he does a Todd Rundgren song, actually. Which I remember thinking was kind of cool. But now I'm going to have to go back and listen to it again. I think Rick Springfield should come on this podcast.
Absolutely.
Because I'd be able to talk to him about all the records that he never talks about.
All the dogs he's had over time.
Well, when you think about your own career, let's think about, like, when you were just in your early 20s and maybe making your first solo albums, which I got to watch you make and hear you kind of write and stuff. I mean, do you ever find yourself drawing anything from those days now? Or do you ever think, well, I learned something then that made a difference and now I'm implementing that, you know? Or I don't know, what do you think? Or how have you evolved creatively, or what's your process like over the years?
I remember freshman year at Luther, there's a guy a couple doors down that fancied himself a songwriter. And he was just sort of, you know, strum, like at camp or something. And I didn't think any of the songs were that great, but I wasn't doing anything. So I sort of wanted to hear whatever he had. And he said, you know, trust your creativity. Because I was asking him, well, I don't know if I, you know, what I'm writing, it doesn't sound like James Taylor or the Beatles. And he said, well, that's good, because we've already got a James Taylor and the Beatles. We, you know, trust who you are and your uniqueness. Or that's the way I'd filter it now to say. And that's still something really important to me, that word uniqueness. The world works best when each person is living out his or her uniqueness. And that's like from the metaphor of church, that we're one body, many members. And that's if, as an artist, what if I don't do that? What if I don't think I'm unique? Because it's hard to be unique sometimes. You know, when I think back 7th and 8th grade, it's not cool to be unique. You want to fit in, and you want to do and dress, you know, to sort of be like everybody else. Or at least there's that instinct. But to begin to trust a person's instincts and... uniqueness, even specifically, like to write with a pen on paper, you know, I'm just thinking about rhymes for this next line, and I'm going to make a list of the rhymes that make sense, and to just trust that, okay, there's some process going on here, and it's not going to be like anybody else is going to do that, and just say, this is my little way.
Did you think you were aware back then that you had a unique voice, or did you were you able to identify it? Yeah, this feels like my perspective, or this is the Richard way to. I mean, did you have a sense of that even then?
I don't know. The first little tape we made is called "The Heart and Physics," and it was made on a Tascam four track, sort of Frankenstein together with another four track. And my buddy Jim helped me set up a thing, and so we did that. It was mostly acoustic guitars, and so there were a couple of songs with a sequencer, you know, where I programmed drums and things. But I remember feeling like those songs were really important, like being the first time to really do songs that I'd written and kind of, you know, lyrics and arrangements and stuff like that, and really having a good time with it, and then sort of not caring too much if anybody else cared about it. But being, I don't know, there's that dialogue, I suppose, that an artist has about being self-conscious about their choices. Like, is this the melody I want? I don't know if that's, well, just, you know, at some point you just need to go with that. Mm-hmm. And the title to this song is going to be this, really? I don't know if that makes sense to anybody else, but yeah, that's what it's going to be.
I think that first album, which I have and know about, it does have a lot in common with what you're even doing now. Of course, you've evolved and everything, but I think it's a identifiable, it's the same person who made that record and who made like your new one. You know, there's identifiable, it's you.
Yeah.
Way back then and as it is right now.
I think one thing that's changed is my maybe an approach. Well, it's probably a seasonal thing. Like initially I wanted to express something of my own story, like you were saying, just to peel off some idea and see what happens if I pay attention to it and form it like a song. So on that first thing, there's a few love songs and some fun songs too. So I think the first things I did were mostly songs about me and my experience and wanting to document. I think that was a big thing. I was journaling a lot at the time. Like every day that was a process, just sort of reflecting what happened today, how did I feel about it. Typical introvert kind of thing, I suppose. And then, you know, I think all that has gravitated now or evolved to what I'm most interested in right now is community singing. And so the art back then was kind of a folk sensibility, maybe. The most important thing is telling this story. And the music is going to be pretty melodic. But it's all about saying whatever I want to say. And now,
I think that's like a typical pop songwriter.
Maybe so.
In their early 20s.
Probably. Maybe so.
That might have something to do with
it. You know, those first few albums that you made after Heart and Physics are... they're songwriter albums. They're pop, folk pop songwriter albums about your life and, you know, and that's what most songwriters do, is that kind of thing.
Yeah. And then now, in probably the last 12 years or so, my main interest has been, what is it like to have a song to sing together in a community? And it seems like the art or the craft of making that sort of song calls for a different approach. Then for everyone to sort of agree we're going to sing this song like in church or at a library or, you know, in a circle of kids or whatever, then the melody needs to be a little more distinct. The words need to be something that everyone can understand and get on board with.
Yeah.
And, you know, have possibilities for harmonizations that kind of make sense in our culture. Right now I'm just mostly fascinated with that sort of form.
That's interesting too, because I think people are singing together less.
Yeah.
Together than they were even 20 years ago. I mean, a lot of people don't have any community outlet for singing other than, you know, they got their headphones in or they're watching a show or something, but they're not in a room.
I think it's an interesting time to think about that. When I was at this youth event I was talking about with the guitar mishap, talking with some youth directors, and the 7th and 8th graders that were there were not singing very much or very loudly. And I was just kind of a couple of the youth people were sort of apologizing to me on their behalf, saying, oh, they don't know how to sing. And I was all right with it because I'm used to people singing or not singing if they want to or not want to. But we became a little philosophical. Like, well, it's possible that, you know, this generation doesn't have a lot of practice singing together, like maybe at a ball game or at a dance.
Happy birthday.
Happy birthday is a big one. And maybe
national anthem,
maybe. But even then, that was an example too. But now you have divas that step up to do that, and you can't sing along with them because they're doing all the dipsy doodly, you know. Yeah. So it's not a sing along anymore. At least the ones that are televised, you know, they're big. But that was interesting. It's possible that the culture is not in them to when we're asked to sing, we can sing. I don't even know what that feels like to me. You know, I'm just curious about that.
I think I'm noticing out in sort of the pop music world that even if the audience isn't consciously aware how much they want to sing together or need to sing together, they're starving for it. And if the artist is talented enough to organize a moment that everybody can jump in on, the audience just goes absolutely wild to do their part. Like, so some examples, I remember right when I moved to Minneapolis, I went to see Gillian Welch and David Rawlings at the Fine Line.
Yeah.
And it was sold out, or, you know, it was really full. It was, and there's no seats. So everybody's standing up, sort of like a rock show, even though they were doing this quiet folky music. And at the end of the show, during the encore, they sang one of the tunes from the O Brother, Where Art Thou record. I don't know if it was like, you know, I'll Fly. I think it was I'll Fly Away.
Yeah, I think she does that.
And she did that at the end. And of course, everybody wanted to sing. And the audience just blew the roof off. Now, of course, it's in Minneapolis where everybody is. I mean, this is a more musical state than Indiana, for example. But man, they sang and it felt so beautiful to have, you know, 600 people singing really loudly and in harmony in this rock and roll club.
Yeah.
And then I remember it was almost 10 years ago now when Ben Folds did that live solo album. Do you have that one?
Mm-mm.
It's recorded in big, huge theaters where it's just him playing the grand piano. And he, before a couple of the different songs, he instructs the audience, okay, you're going to sing on the chorus and you have different parts. And so he divides the audience up into doing like, whoa, whoa, and he teaches them and then they can harmonize. And then he starts the song and you can tell it's just awesome. And everybody's having so much fun and there's that sort of churchy feel because
it's a congregation.
It's a congregation, yeah. and they're just starved. They just want to do it so bad, and they just love to do that. And you know, those of us who occasionally get to play church music gigs, we're sort of spoiled because we're often put in situations where we can organize the singing of hundreds of people together. Sometimes really loud and confidently, where people really know their parts and they can just blow the roof off. And that's extraordinary.
Yeah.
Oh, you know, and I was thinking too about like Mumford and Sons, who just exploded a few years ago.
Right.
And I don't have their records or really know their music, but I was at a friend's house and he was like, you got to see this video. And he put in a DVD of them at Red Rocks. And, you know, all their songs have choruses that go, whoa, whoa. You know, it's like super anthemic with lots of long vowels and stuff. And they just get that place singing with them, and the audience just is blissing out.
Mm-hmm.
And it feels so good to be in the audience in a moment like that where you can just let it rip and hear the voices of other human beings. You know, that's amazing.
Yeah, that is a special thing. And we don't know how to do that with very few exceptions. I can't think of one right now. But without someone to organize, as you're saying, without somebody to lead and say, okay, we're going to do this, and this half of you sing this. I don't know. Is that becoming more rare, or are we becoming more, I don't know. It is a beautiful thing. And to me, it's like performance art. you know, that you don't know that you're going to be invited to do all the time. I think church is at its best. Maybe you could think of as performance art. Like this song, if we all dig down and put some energy into this hymn, this song, or whatever it is, we're going to create something that's going to last, you know, that 2.5 minutes or whatever, and then it's going to be over. So we're going to put ourselves into it right here and right now. And we're going to listen to the people next to us. We're going to hear our parents and our grandkids and our kids sing together, and we're going to feel that resonance in our bodies, and we're going to make something beautiful, and then it's going to be gone. And there's something really exquisite about that. I mean, it's kind of a basic thing, blissing out on a song, but I love thinking about
well,
that.
Well, it's too, thinking about that being one of the last or one of the only settings where a child could be surrounded by a human voice like that. And that's such a unique experience for them because it's melodic and it's singing versus a child just being in like a big crowd, or you're at the mall, or you're at the loud, noisy pool, or something where, you know, the decibel level is pretty high, but it's not organized as music. And then when I think about a child who sits in a congregation and, you know, for that hour hears maybe 5 or 6 or 7 times, like they know it's music, you know, and it's, to me, that's a really... That's a unique experience that I can't think of a lot of other facets of our culture where a family could take a young child and say, okay, you know, we're going to be surrounded by people sitting, you know, singing together for these different times.
And you get to be a part of that.
You get to be a part of that. Yeah.
It reminds me of all the stories you hear from the bluegrass community and from the folky scene where there'll be multi-generations of folk musicians.
Yeah.
And it's because they say, well, when I was a baby, they would have rehearsal or hootenannies in the living room. And I grew up with all these riff-raffy musicians coming over to the living room, and they would play till 3 a.m. and it was harmonies. And I would saw along on my fiddle when I was 3 years old, and it's all I've ever known, you know.
Right.
And it's been interesting for me to get to, you know, play Nordic folk music and get to meet some real people steeped in the tradition going back generations, going back to the 1800s, where that's like a real experience for real people. And, you know, and there are people in the bluegrass scene who talk about that kind of lifestyle. Or like one of my favorite bands currently is this band Heim. Do you know that group? It's three sisters from LA.
No.
And their parents were musicians playing at bars and festivals and stuff. And then they got their daughters in the band as soon as they could hold an instrument, and now they were nominated for Best New Artist at the Grammys this year. And they're a great band, but they grew up with those harmonies and that resonance in their home and in their daily life, and think, wow, what's going on developmentally?
Yeah, and how different that is from a planned 45-minute weekly music class at the local community, you know, that's not an organic way, I think, for kids to encounter music. I mean, not to say that's not a good thing to take music lessons or that sort of thing.
Yeah.
But I
might still feel like a class.
Yeah, yeah, or an obligation, or like I'm not good enough yet to be playing with kids who are older than me or people who are better than me. And I just,
yeah,
there's something pretty amazing about just everybody being all together. And
well, you two that do that well with your kids, and with our 13-year-old Sam. We sing in our house all the time. We sing about, you know, the dog and the kid. Everybody, all our animals have theme songs and have little voices we do. So we sing about, you know, what Will the dog did and what, and sing in the car. And was it like a year ago? Maybe it was like 2 years ago, maybe. Sam was able to pick out like a third harmony. If Trish and I were doing melody in one harmony, and he would be hearing something. And he would just, we just practice like the same little refrain. I can't remember what song it was that we were doing. And there's something special, like a light turned on for him. Like, ooh, I'm hearing this and I can do it. And let's try it again. Do it again. All right now. And then, oh, what happens if I sing the melody and you change to that part? It's just a practice of listening, I think, that is becoming really important in our family. I think Trish and I, too, in our marriage, music has been really important. And I'm not sure always why. Trish has a wonderful voice and is a great musician. I just love listening to her, but I love singing with her too. It's sometimes I say I feel like it's a practice of physically listening to each other that makes it special, and the act of harmonizing, in this case musically. But there's something about our relationship that's it's like not just a metaphor for a relationship. It's enacting something that's important about our relationship. We get grumpy if we don't sing with each other after a while.
Wow. I know Sam has made vocal appearances on your recordings for many years, even when he was just a little kid.
Yeah.
And I know he gets credited on your most recent record, your most recent solo album. But what's it like to be a parent where both the parents are freelance musicians and then to have a child? It seems like your raising of him has been pretty chilled out. For example, like he's not on stage with you, at least that I've ever seen.
Yeah, he's not interested in that at this point.
So you haven't been like stage Michael Jackson's dad.
Yeah, yeah.
He doesn't have like the sequin jumpsuit.
Well, we could try that. I wonder where that, yeah. Dance, monkey, dance. So,
did you make a conscious decision when he was just little that, you know, you're not going to do any excessive pushing?
Oh, I don't know. We didn't even talk about it. I think it's just not in us to kind of push that way. We've invited him and like said, oh, we could, you know, this song we're singing, we do that on stage. You could join us. Nope. Okay. Well, if you ever change your mind, you know,
you can
do that. But it's been fun to hear Sam's voice change too. So he's 13 now. And when we go to church choir right across the street, you know, I sing tenor. Trish goes to the alto section, and Sam's a bass.
Wow.
So that's fun for me making records, because he can do a low you know, pitch that, I mean, I can get to, but it just sounds really cool coming out of his body together.
You've taken him on tour a lot, so even though he's not on stage with you, he's on the road, he's working the merch table.
Right.
Seems like he really likes to work the merch table.
That's has gone in seasons. Sometimes he's been excited about it, and other times he tolerates it. Like, and we just tell him, "Well, this is a family business. You're learning the family business, and this is your part." And he's the one that is most up on, you know, like, "Dad, sure, tell him you're on Facebook. You know, tell him you're on iTunes. Don't forget the thing with the, you know, tweet us. Tell
he's
him
the
that
promotion,
right.
The promotion
he's all over the promotion thing. It's like second nature to him." Like with the conversation you had with Clint about gaming culture and how what a gift it is to be in touch with gaming culture that has, you know, playfulness and low consequences for failure. You know, just respawn for crying out loud. It's not a big deal. It's just nice to have a kid around in the midst of music work.
I thought it was really fun, the couple gigs that we've done in the last few years, like the Yovo Soccer thing and some other stuff, where there were kind of big gigs with lots of people, and there were other musicians, other artists on the bill, and it was, like, Sam seemed like he was having a lot of fun, and he was super social, very easy to be with, great, like, social skills, and affectionate and fun, and not, like, awkward and freaky.
So I hate you.
So I don't know. It's really fun to have him around. And as like our kids are younger than him, you know, our kids are 11 and 8. And so it's, for me, it's really great to see another parent who's a musician taking the kid to the show and getting the kid in the car and going to the gigs. And like this summer, our family is going to do some driving. Like I have a gig in Georgia, and we're just going to drive down, all of us, and play some concerts. And then the event itself where I'll play is down there. And so our kids will be along for that. And I'm interested to see what that's, they'll probably, I mean, when we've done it short term in the past, they just love it. They think it's the coolest, most fun thing ever.
The pool accounts for
the pool 90, is big.
90% of that.
Absolutely. The pool is big. Yeah.
The pool and the hotel television to watch, like, Nickelodeon or whatever.
Well, I think for Sam, he's been, as he's grown up, he's had this curious sort of sense of, Mom and Dad have this weird job, and, like they do music, and there's people who do music on the radio, and like, are you guys famous? I remember him asking us this when he was like five or something, six. You know, are you famous? He's asking his parents, are you famous? Part of me wanted to go, yes, yes, son, we're really, really famous. We're rock stars, pretty much, so get used to that. But, you know, it's, he knows so many musicians, like, you know, he's seen you all, and, you know, a lot of our friends are performers, artists, so he just sort of knows this is a way to do life in the world. And when he was in, let's see, fourth grade, we decided to begin homeschooling. And so we decided for this year, let's try this. We kind of always wondered if we wanted to do that. And so it kind of became a thing. Well, if we don't do it, we're always going to wonder. We got to try this, see what happens. And mostly the push came because we were traveling so much. And we just wondered as a question, what would it be like to, instead of orienting our lives, all three of our lives, around the school calendar, what if we like remove that school calendar? That means we can go away for a weekend, but we don't have to be back on Monday. We can stay in St. Louis and go to the museum, or we can take a long weekend, and among our performances, we can spend time with people, we can notice what the food is like. The homeschool thing can be a year-round, you know, practice of noticing. And that's been really great. So we've had like a pocket of friends and fans in Fort Worth and a pocket of friends and fans in Colorado. So for the last bunch of years, we've gone out there like once a year. So he's been able to get to know what it's like to be in Texas. Food's different. The geography is different. The language is different. I love that he has that sense of the world being different from Iowa. And when we go out in Colorado, you know, people speak a little differently there. We notice the geography, culture. That's just really cool. I never did that much traveling when I was a kid. So I feel like his world, he's just more aware of diversity maybe than mm-hmm. I was. Mm-hmm. That's I love that. Mm-hmm. And he just drinks it in. He's not critiquing it. He's just saying, wow, that's great. Yeah. Mm-hmm. So we continue to homeschool, and it's not, I think every year we just sort of ask ourselves, is this working still? Is this okay? And yeah, I guess so. Okay, good. So we'll keep doing that. Mm-hmm. And I don't know, you know, how long we'll do that, but as long as it's still seems like, you know, we're making progress and he's enjoying it.
Good.
As you talk about how a child response to their artistic parents, I was thinking about my daughter Svea, who's 8, and in the last couple months she's asked me this question a couple different times, where she'll say, are there people in the world who have your album who you don't know? And
yeah, I remember Sam asking that same question,
and then I consciously or whatever, I know of course there are, but I never think about that. And so when she asks that question, I sort of step back and actually think about it for real. And it's amazing to me that that's the truth, that there are people who I've never met who have these songs as a part of the soundtrack of their life. And they've never seen me in concert. I don't know who they are. We might not even have any people in common, like in a 2 degrees of separation sort of thing. Like, they're complete strangers. Yeah. And I think that's just extraordinary. And like, here's a crazy thing. Like, this podcast has been live now for about 5 days. And my parents called me the other day. They called me yesterday. And they've never listened to a podcast before, so they don't know about podcasting. But my dad was at Menards shopping for building supplies or something. And some dude from, like, this is in Michigan, far away from here, he came up to my dad and said, I've been listening to your son's podcast and it's awesome. And then he said, there's only a couple episodes up, so I've listened to them both twice. So he's like re-listening. And I've never met this guy. I have no idea who he is.
And your dad was very, very confused.
Yeah, my dad was like, what are you talking about?
He didn't know what it was, because he doesn't... He's not checking out the iPad. So
well, then my parents do have an iPad. So after this happened, then I talked my mom and I talked her through like how to download the podcast on an iPad so they can listen. They probably listen by now. But it was just amazing to me like that. Wow, there's people out there who are interacting with the art that you make and that I make and that anybody makes. And thankfully, thanks to the internet especially, it's just out in the world. And there are just random people, you know, accessing it and maybe even enjoying it. You know, it's incredible.
Possibly, yeah.
And so, I don't know, I'm interested for you, like, how have you seen your work surface out in the world in a surprising way? Has anybody ever sent you an email and about a certain song or about a certain album or people you don't know? Or, I don't know, do you have any experiences like that?
I think that is a remarkable... just the prospect that you could have an influence on someone through a song that you don't know. Because music tends to be, we think of it as a pretty intimate connection that you would have for someone. Like, you know, long distance dedication, this love song to, you know, goes out to Betty from Jonah or whatever. Or I'm writing this song for you or on behalf of this person. Or here's a song for a community to sing together. It's very... you know, it can be emotional. It can be, can really bring people together. So the idea that someone could have such an intimate experience with music miles away or countries away, a language away, it really is remarkable, I think. And I think that goes, I think that works across different art media too. You know, I'm thinking of film and visual arts. Also, in particular, sculpture. Last year was a big year. I had two songs published in the new Presbyterian hymnal, and this was sort of a dream of mine—a totally geeky dream. I don't know how long I've had this, but I always felt like that would really mark some sense of influence that I really wanted to have. I wanted to see that. Well, maybe as a question, could I have something among the hymn tradition in a book? And for my tradition, the hymnal, you know, sort of represents a lot of the language,
the symbols, signs
of our language for faith. And so there's a certain reverence, at least, you know, when I was growing up with the hymnal. So it meant something to me, the prospect of just being one voice among that sort of company, kind of like great cloud of witnesses sort of moment. I'm very humbled and grateful to have that sort of thing. So I hear from a lot of people these days for a song called "O Christ, Surround Me" that I wrote about 11 years ago at seminary. And I mean, it's weird how songs, you know, sometimes incubate and they take a while to spin out into certain circles. So, you know, I don't know, maybe a song I'm writing this week won't really be heard by that many people for, you know, another 10 years or something. And then that might be out there in the world in a different way. But when it comes to congregational songs, I think what means the most to me about having a hymn there is it, again, it's sort of loaded with the meaning from when I was a kid even. Like, these are the songs we sing in worship that are formational, that are teaching us how to be humans. You know, the lyrics and the melodies, the harmonies, this is one way we enact how we are a community. So that's just a big deal. Sometimes I feel the responsibility of that as a writer, and then sometimes just sort of sit back and say, holy cow, look at that. That's amazing that music works that way. I can't believe I get to be a part of that. I was with my friend Brian today for lunch, Brian Sergio, another great songwriter. And we were just laughing at, we're both freelance musicians full time. He was saying, you know, who goes out and may spend, you know, a year, 3 years of their life making an album, you know, doing a project that no one has asked you to do? For a lot of people with a job, that makes no sense at all. But those of us who are sort of have that vocation, yeah, we don't know who cares or who's going to buy it or if it's going to make money or break even or whatever. I mean, there's ways to design that's smart, but, you know, you kind of do these projects that you have high hopes for in terms of influence and sort of send it out there and kind of wait and see.
Yeah, instead of focus groups and stuff on the front end, you make the product first and then have to find the audience later.
Yeah, that's what it is. Exactly.
That reminds me, I'm reading the book The Interestings right now, and I was just reading a sentence from the main character talking about being a theater major and saying that she had never had her parents, well, her father had died, so her mother, she said ultimately she wasn't good enough to succeed at that. Her mother had never given her the brochure for, like, here's law school to fall back on. And she said, no one ever falls back on theater. Like, well, you know, if this accounting thing doesn't work out, I can always go into theater. And I think music is kind of like that, too. Like, it's never the plan B.
Yeah.
You know? Like, well, you know,
the job security
if plan
part.
A doesn't work out, I can always be a freelance touring singer-songwriter.
That's like their stability fallback.
Yeah. Good. that struck me today. So is your discipline of writing, has that been consistent for you throughout your career? Like you had talked about putting pen to paper, are you still a pen and ink kind of writer? Do you sing stuff into your phone? Do you use your computer, your notes function? Like, what is your process? And then I know for Jonathan, like, he will go months and months and months and months without writing anything and not being remotely interested in writing anything because it's not that cycle of his creative life. Mm-hmm. Could you talk a little bit about your creative life? And then how does that ever interface with Trish's? Or are you sometimes in the same cycles together and sometimes not? Or like, what does that look and feel like for you?
I was, I told Sam the other day at breakfast, I'm working on a new song. And he said, oh, can I hear it? Like, he assumed that he meant I was recording it in the studio and could I play it for him? And I said, no, I mean, I'm working on a song, like I'm working on the lyrics and the melody and things, which means I've got my blank book from Barnes & Noble open. And I've got my, you know, third draft of verse 3 or whatever it is I'm working on a song. And that was interesting to me because I know a lot of musicians that have a preference for some part of the process of making a song. Because there's the craft of writing, lyrics, melody, and harmonization. I sort of consider that the song, I guess, in its essence. And then after the song is done, in my mind, then you can think about, well, maybe I'll record this. And if it's a good song, it could stand probably a whole lot of different arrangements. Does this want to be a country song or a acapella chant or a rock and roll thing? Or, I mean, there's usually something there in the song that suggests the arrangement. But so you dream up an arrangement, and then there's the actual recording and producing and putting the sounds on virtual tape. And I know a lot of musicians that, you know, they live for the recording, and that's, so that final version of it is sort of the best they can do to represent that song. My favorite part is the very front part of that. When I feel like the lyric and the melody and the harmonization is right, that's, I just love that. That's, I would say, a spiritual practice for me because it's very reflective and it has me challenged to trust my creativity, trust my uniqueness, all that sort of thing. Trust that I have a vocation to have this voice that's important somehow beyond myself, and that sort of thing. So I think I love writing, and I'm usually writing all the time with something. And then for the first time in a long while, this last year, I had a couple months where I wasn't working on anything, but just traveling. And I wasn't even scratching out anything. These days I'm studying the Psalms. So my aim, I'm about 11 years into this little Psalm project, writing songs for each of the 150 Psalms, and there's probably going to be more than that. It's more than just the writing song. It's also soaking in the texts and sort of stretching with them. But I could really feel that I hadn't been writing. I really missed it. It was like a craving that I imagine some people have for exercise. If you're a runner and you don't get to run for a week or whatever, my best friend Michael, he gets agitated and kind of grumpy if he can't get out to run. That's definitely not my thing with my physical body. I don't like exercise. I try to do it, but I've wanted to like it, but I can't.
But it's like atrophy a little bit. Like, you know, like they would feel it in their muscles or their breath. You know, mm-hmm. you feel it in your, those creative places in your brain.
Yeah. It just feels like that's where juices flow, and I just love how that feels when things come together.
Yeah. Well, that's great to hear that you write, that you're writing really regularly like that, because I know creatives have all different ways to do that. So I always, mm-hmm. you know, I know when he's, I never consider it, oh, Jonathan's in a dry spell, like, because he's not writing anything. It's sort of like, well, no, the field must rest before the soil is prepared again. So, but I know people have just all different ways of doing that. Does that align at all with Trisha's creative process? Are you more similar in that way, or does she have a really different way of doing that, that you've sort of had to get to know each other's processes in that way?
We're both really independent and go after that in different ways. Mm-hmm. So I tend to start with lyrics, and then as I work with lyrics, there's usually a song form that develops. Mm-hmm. Like, is this going to be a chorus or a, you know, versus chorus with a bridge sort of thing, or a hymn or whatever form it is. And then after I'm working with the form of just the lyrics, there's usually a sense of how many syllables or how many feet to a line, and then that suggests a rhythm. And then usually as I'm working with that, there'll be a sense of melody. So that's my favorite way, where the melody is sort of working itself out before I grab a melodic instrument, or like before I look for a guitar or something mm-hmm. else. And I'm always having a digital recorder on my phone there to record something. I just don't trust my memory to...
Right.
So any crappy little idea I have, I'm going to slip it on. And I had to upgrade to another recorder because the one little handheld one I got, digital recorder, was full. So I have two little recorders I'm always carrying in my satchel with me. And some of those recordings, I don't know, they must be like 8 years old, which seems silly because it's more like a vault now of ideas. I don't know if I'll ever go back to those.
You could harvest them. You could like set aside an afternoon and just listen to the old ideas.
Every once in a while I do that with my newer one. But you know, that reminds me of a time earlier in songwriting where I was writing down on paper all these ideas. I have notebooks full of things. I was feeling like that was, or people would look at me and say, wow, you're really prolific. That's a lot of stuff. And I'd say, well, it's just, I don't know, just ideas. And I felt like the feeling behind it was, I've got to write these ideas down because one day this will all stop. This creativity will be gone. And in my old age, I will look back at these notebooks and I could maybe write a song from these fragments, this old lore or something.
The mine will close. Like, yeah. You will have mined all the minerals out of it and the mine will close. And
there really was kind of a fear of this part of my livelihood could dry up at any time. I don't think I have that. I really don't have that fear anymore, but it's interesting. I still have a box of it's more like a scrapbook, a box of old notebooks and stuff with little, you know, napkins and matchbook covers and scribbles and stuff.
So your experience and your wisdom over the years has relaxed you in a way regarding not being concerned about future productivity. Is that what I'm hearing you say?
Yeah, I think so. I think one of my favorite authors is Thomas More, the contemporary Thomas More, who says the first half of your life, you're concerned about details, you're concerned about rules, the minutia of life, you're focused on particulars, and you're wanting to know how all that works. The second part of your life, you're just letting all that go.
Hmm.
And I think that's been my experience as a 47-year-old. I don't know when that turn maybe came or tipped, but I feel like there's a, maybe it's more of an emergence of a different attitude than a tip exactly. But there's certain aspects of my life I do feel like I trust more than I used to. That's probably one way. I feel like, yeah, I think I do have this sensibility for wanting to document ideas with words and music, and I can look back and say, yeah, there's been cycles and seasons of that, and it's changed over time. It'll probably continue. It'll probably continue to change. And, yeah.
I like talking to artists like you, like I was saying before, with a long-term career, and also like Kelly Newcomer a couple episodes ago.
She was great.
Who also has, you know, 20-plus years of making art, because... Oh, well, how was I going to phrase this? I had something specific I was going to say about it. But just being able to... something about, like, not worrying about the fact that something's going to dry up. You know, mm-hmm. It's sort of trusting that, you know... Oh, this is what I was going to say. I was, you know, especially in the music business, and if you're playing in a rock band especially, there's so many artists who quit and drop out and get another job and stop writing songs and stop making records. And actually, I think that's probably the most artists. I think this, maybe not so much anymore because now everybody's indie. But back in the day when you needed to get signed and be on a label, like you were lucky, maybe you'd make two records on your label or three, and then your band would break up or you'd get dropped, and then you'd have to get a job. And then you'd like become a real estate agent or a teacher, you know, you just get some other job and you wouldn't be a musician anymore. And then so you had a period of productivity where you made a bunch of songs and albums and recordings and tours, and then you just completely stopped. And, you know, and I know people like that. And then, of course, there's nothing wrong with that, but it's pretty unusual to meet somebody who just kept on going and going and going, and it's kind of like, wow, you just didn't stop. It's awesome, you know. And as I get older, I'm feeling a little bit lonely, I think, because I have a hard time relating. I just feel like, oh, I don't know a lot of people who I really get or who I feel like get me. So it's awesome for me to find, like, I feels good to talk to people like you, because then I think, oh, you know what's going on, or, you know, and then it's inspiring. And that's why, I don't know, as I get older too, that's why I really appreciate someone like Todd Rundgren or Bruce Cockburn.
Yeah.
Who just keep on going, even though, like, there's periods where nobody cares and they get dropped from their label and they can't sell as many tickets, but they just keep making records and gigging and doing all, you know, I just think it's extraordinary. It's so cool.
I've decided that part of the reason I'm an independent musician is because it's good for me to have this perspective on life. It puts me in a position of how do I want to say this? It's a life of trust. That word has become really important to me the last few years. A life of trust. And it puts me in a position where I am doing... that. Let's see, what do I mean by that? It's not about, like, this is a job that doesn't have a regular paycheck. You know, like, I saw Randy Stonehill in concert a couple of years ago, and he was explaining to the audience, I love my job, this is an interesting job, you know, it does not come with dental or 401k, and he moves on to, you know, call for the free will offering for that little church that he was doing. It's a weird job, and it's not the same sort of stability that some other jobs provide. Not everybody needs that sort of thing. Not everybody needs this sort of edge of trust. I guess what I mean is part of my livelihood is paying attention to what I feel like I want to say in the world and respond to what's happening in the world. So this last album is called Love Stands With, and it's songs for longing and justice. Because I felt like there's a whole lot going on in the world that I want to speak to in terms of our longing as a planet and as humanity. So that was really important for me to pay attention to. So I get the luxury, the privilege of having space that my whole vocation starts with, that idea that I have space and my job is to respond, be in dialogue with the news, with other artists, with other people, and ask myself, what do we need to sing right now about the world?
I want to ask you about your new album, because I was just thinking about this before you came over, that it seems to me like your new album, and maybe even the ones a little bit before, are kind of activist art. And in rock and roll music, anyway, these days, it seems to me like that's not quite as popular as it has been in the past. Like, and when I was...
I'm bringing it back.
You're bringing it back. And I think about, like, what was going on in the 80s. Man, there was a lot of activist art. There were... And people like, you know, well, Bruce Coburn, for example, was writing activist music in the 80s. And Springsteen and the Indigo Girls kind of came out of that. And Tracy Chapman and even Sting. And, you know, there was kind of this Live Aid, We Are the World kind of, you know, it was activist music. And I think it was drawing from the 60s and early Bob Dylan sort of thing, or Pete Seeger, like way, way back. Yeah. But, you know, I'm not seeing a heck of a lot of that these days. But as I, you know, think about your new album, there's all those lyrics about, like, what's the one about let anger motivate us? Or, you know what song I'm talking about? Let anger, what does it call us to do, make a difference?
Or, yeah.
You know, and then you've got, you know, lyrics that are kind of provocative. And, you know, I mean, it's kind of a cry. It's a, you know, justice-related album.
Yeah, well, the record before this was very contemplative, and it was all based on the Psalms. Both the last two records are centered in particular Psalm texts that I'm interpreting. They're not like verbatim texts just peeled out of the Bible to sing. They're kind of set in a particular way. So the record before this was called, what was it called? Our Roots Are In You. And it's a very contemplative chant. Very simple songs that are repeated. So, you know, if you stand up and sing this song once or twice, everybody in the room is going to be able to sing along with it. Very simple. And then the second one, The Love Stands With, that came after that, is kind of the opposite. Whereas that other one is very quiet and simple, this one's loud and is going to bother you.
I think the first song on your album is the loudest song that I've ever heard you record.
Yeah.
That's a really, like, crunchy,
it probably is,
rocking tune.
Yeah. It's called Deliver Us, and it's it is. And all those, the theme of that album is about longing and justice, and in particular from the Psalms, these ancient songs of Israel who, you know, are having a hard time of it. What is it like to feel longing? And in the 21st century, how do we express that? It's not like we don't have longing. But is there a place to share that? Is that a safe place to share in your family or with a friend or with your parents or with your kids? When things aren't right and you're feeling disappointed or feel loss, can we talk about those things? And in particular, when I see the evolution of the church in the United States, I think, is that something we're practicing in the way we sing, in the way we talk about what humans are for and what God is like? Are laments okay? A lot of times when I'm traveling, doing concerts and doing workshops, it's presenting these songs that nobody really wants to sing. it's songs that are angry and sad. And I do lots of other songs too, but what I try to make a point of is to say, would it stretch your community if you were on a regular basis giving yourself a diet of not only happy songs, but also some songs that remind us that the world is a broken place and we are in a big process of healing. And some of us today are feeling some loss. And would you just be tender with each other? Let's practice what it's like to live and love the whole world by doing that in this room today and caring for each other. And a song can help you do that.
I like that one from an album or two ago, but The Witness of Suffering. The people are the witness of suffering. And oh, man.
Your people lament. Yeah. Yeah, sometimes just witnessing, being with people. Sometimes there's nothing to say. My dad was diagnosed with a brain tumor a few months ago. And I've really appreciated people that have just called or written to say, there's nothing to say. Yeah. this really sucks, and tell me what's happening. That being with compassion is something important to practice, I think, and enact. Hmm. So I'm hoping the songs will help do that.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Well, we were wondering if you could... if you could go back and talk to kindergartner Richard.
Oh, but before we do, that, you have to get to the airport.
Yeah.
Right?
Oh, yeah, I suppose so.
But the final question from Dawn, how would you like these listeners to find you?
Oh.
I've got two main websites. If you're into the Psalms, specifically, psalmimmersion.com is sort of the bank of all my Psalm songs, and for each of the psalm texts, 1 to 150, what I'm working on is a page for each one that includes some Bible study kinds of things, reflections, prayers, some theological reflection, as well as music. So go there. And if you're not so much into the psalms in particular, worldmaking.net is my other publishing site that has songs for other things like that. I tweet at Pomo Psalmist. And you can find me on Facebook. Oh, there's a Facebook page, too, if you're into the Psalms. The Psalm Immersion Project, if you want a regular feed of reflection on Psalms.
How's that? Excellent. Yeah, perfect. Because hopefully, you know, you'll get some visitors.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And your music is on iTunes?
Yeah, you can find it on iTunes and Bandcamp.
And you have a band with your spouse, River's Voice?
Sure enough. Yeah, Trish and I sing together under River's Voice. And we're doing some things next month, in fact, together.
And those are also on iTunes under that band name?
Correct? Yeah, thank you. Yeah.
Is there a riversvoice.com website for the band?
Yeah, we haven't done much with that recently, but yes, you can find it there.
And those are great records, too.
Thanks.
And Trish has a great record.
Yeah, her last record, Wild Acre, is really great. Bluegrass. Yeah. Well, this is great. Thanks for the podcast. I love what you're doing in the world.
It worked out perfect.
I want to interview you guys sometimes for this, because being the creatives that you are, you're bringing this out of people, but I think you should think about showcasing yourselves too sometime.
Well, we'll see.
We wondered if there's a period of time where we don't have any more guests and we really need a show, then I would interview Dawn and she'd be the guest.
Oh, yeah,
and
that'd work.
She could interview me and I'd be the guest. That's when... if we're like, oh my gosh, we need an episode, and we're all out of them.
That's not living a life of trust, though, is it? Do you think that we're going to run out of
imagining
guests?
That humans will disappear from the planet.
There will be no more creative people to talk to.
Thankfully, we've got a ton of people just in the last day, actually, who want to be on the show, who we're excited about.
Yeah,
so
yeah.
There's going to be more episodes. It's so nice to... Thanks, Richard.
Thanks, Richard.
We'll wrap it up, Dawn.
Sure. So I'm wondering what you would tell kindergartner Richard.
Oh, let's see. Kindergarten. Miss Bartles was my teacher. Miss Bartles was great. I'm thinking about little Richard. Not like, good girl, the Miss Bartles. Let me rephrase.
What would you tell little Richard? Oh, that is really good.
I think I might say something about, well, what's on my mind these days. It seems to be, a growing thing for me is that sense of trusting your uniqueness. That, little Richard, you can trust your uniqueness. I remember in kindergarten, it was me and Sharissa Broadwater in class that could read in kindergarten. And we were sort of showcased in ways that I didn't really like now Richard is going to read this for us. Isn't that great that Richard can read? Oh, wow. And I just felt like, oh, geez, that's not how I want to, this isn't helping playground time for me. So I think it would be something like, each person's uniqueness is brilliant. Be that, do that, trust that.
Excellent. Thanks for being here. Off you go to the airport. Thanks, everybody, for listening. Good night.
Creativity.